Praise the Lord. Hey, I know I might. I guess it's okay if I blow this. Christopher, I just feel like we ought to maybe start off Pentecost with a shofar. Is that right? And thank the Lord for what he just did, okay? Thank you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, good. I think we need to hear from the Lord, and then we just need to act and just trust him. Amen? It doesn't matter. You know, he does things different every single day, and we shouldn't be afraid to just try it because it hasn't been done that way or you haven't done it that way. And just step out and trust in him. I think that's sometimes how we get under the radar, right? And take the blessings. Well, I want to take a minute and share a couple of stories here as we bring Rick up again. And, you know, years ago, we were up at Montreat in the mountains of North Carolina for a Fellowship of Ministries retreat. And it's been, I think, around 20 years or so since the MFM started, the Morningstar Fellowship of Ministries. But after a couple of years, they started the Fellowship of Churches for pastors and so on. And I was interested in that too, but I really felt like there was something more for someone like myself and other people that have ministries like myself. And I talked with Rick and I said, you know, I really feel like you have an anointing that you could do something to network the networkers. Or network the networks, you know. And amazingly, he says to me, he says, you know, we have some friends down in Perth, Australia, and they do that down there in the southern hemisphere, you know. And we're thinking maybe we should do something like that in the northern hemisphere. But anyway, and when he said that, the Holy Spirit said to me, I think this was in the spring sometime, but the Holy Spirit said to me, if I remember right, was like, follow up with him in August, I think is what he said. But anyway, so I just made a mental note of that. And then when August came, I said, well, Lord, you didn't tell me when in August. So I figured what I'll do it is I just picked a day, you know. So I picked this day. And on that day, whatever time it was, I just sat down at the computer and I just sent Rick an email. And I said, hey, have you given any more thought to that word about, you know, networking the networks and the networkers? And it was like 45 minutes later, which is, you know, remarkable, you know, for anybody to email you back. But for Rick, too, you got to send a word, and he's busy. So to get a word back in 45 minutes, and he wrote back, he says, I can't believe you sent this to me. I'm in Perth, Australia right now. I'm getting ready to go into a meeting. I might have an answer in an hour. You know, but then we never talked again for a long time about that, so I don't know what happened in that meeting. The point is that was confirmation to me, at least, of hearing from the Lord. And again, it takes patience because over the years, from time to time, we'll talk a little bit. And Rick will say, hey, what's the Lord saying to you about networking or something like that? We've had little conversations. Then the years have gone by. And again, when the Lord gives you something and you take action on it, you don't always understand. And most of the time, matter of fact, Rick said one time something along the lines of the prophetic is meant to, is, I forget how it goes, so I'm not going to say it's a quote, but something along the lines, prophetic makes more sense after it happens, something like that, okay? And when he said that, I was like, what? And, you know, but it's true. It's true. When you get something and you think you know what it means, maybe you don't. But it doesn't mean it's not from the Lord. But when it happens, you look back at it and say, wow, that was really God. Well, you thought it was God anyway, and it was. It just didn't play out the way you expected. Well, a number of years back, when some things were going on in Washington, and this particular or present administration was doing some things that were pretty concerning, still are, and unconstitutional and so on. And I thank God that Rick saw some of these things and took some action saying, we need to do something, or basically we're going to lose our country. But he called I think it was just called the emergency meeting. That's what I've been calling it because that's the way I remember it. It was an emergency meeting, invitation only through people that he knows, okay? So we came to that meeting. We felt it was important. Terry and I went, and some of our other friends from Missoula went. And eventually that meeting became, or that group, or that gathering turned into what is called the Oak Initiative. It didn't have a name at first. But by the next time we met, there had been a revelation that had been released, and that's where we got the name, the Oak Initiative. So, but I don't remember if it was at that first one that we had or if it was the second one, but at one of those early meetings we were sitting at a table having lunch, and it hit me. Because when I had that revelation years ago, or that, it was a revelation, but also the question about Rick stepping into a different avenue in networking, I have to admit my understanding at that time was limited to the church. Okay, it was limited to networking, people that network within the church, and that's where I function a lot. So that's where my vision was, but the Lord had something different. And in the ensuing years, we'd come to know more things that we understand now in light of the Seven Mountains mandate, in light of getting into all the different aspects of society. And so those two things were happening, but they didn't converge in my mind until we were sitting there at lunch that day. And it dawned on me, because at that very first meeting, there was people there from every avenue and every background. There were military people and ex-military people. There were actresses and people that are in the sports areas. And there was people in the music area. And there was people, of course, in the church, but in the government also, and education. And all the different mountains were there. And it dawned on me that those were all networkers that were all networked in their different spheres of authority. And I said, hey, you remember that word way back then? Do you think maybe this is it? Maybe this is it. It's bigger than I even thought, because it's outside of just the church. Obviously, it includes the church, but it's outside the church. And I don't know, but I think it definitely is. It's part of that. I think the Oak Initiative is part of that, of Rick's call and anointing to network the networkers and network the networks in all these spheres. And, you know, the Oak Initiative has been such a blessing, I think. Matter of fact, I think it's gotten him on the enemy list of the president. But this is one of the groups when they started it up that the IRS went after, one of the conservative groups and so on, and that you've heard about and everything, that have held up, that did hold up the 501c3 for so many years. But this has been so much of a blessing for those of you who care about your country and care about getting Christian people involved in what's going on in the government side of it and what the government's doing. I really want to thank Rick for having the vision to do something, to gather some people together, just to get together and then find out what we can do from here. And that's how the Oak Initiative came about. But you can join it, and you can get online, and you can download the different information there. You can watch the different interviews that are online and on Morningstar TV. You know, one of the interviews, I think I was there when General Boykin was there, and they were just like doing little videos, and they grabbed a couple of us, and they grabbed, I remember General Boykin and I were talking, and they said, we want to do a little video. And they took him in there and said, basically, you know, talk about something. If I remember right. And anyway, he went and talked about something. I didn't know what he talked about till later. But he went in there and sat down. I think it was about 7 minutes on Marxism in America. And that thing went immediately viral. Matter of fact, I think General Boykin was saying that within 24 hours, people he knows were sending this to him saying, you got to listen to this guy. But anyway, and then later they did a more expanded version, but there's so much has come out through the Oak, and I really want to commend it to you as one of the ministries that Rick is involved in, and what a blessing that he has an anointing to release some of these things into our land and into our culture. We're grateful for that, but I wanted to give a little plug for that, and I feel like this is really imperative in our day, and is one of those things that's working to bring salvation to our land and to help, you know, battle to protect the ancient landmarks which our fathers have set. So anyway, I wanted to give that as a little background of one of the many things that Rick is involved in. And as we bring him up, I really want to ask y'all to, you know, be with me and just really welcome him tonight. We're so grateful that he's here. With everything he's got going on and all the other places he could have been, he came all the way out here to be with us in this wonderful place of refuge, you know. And we're so grateful that he's here. So let's welcome Rick Joyner up tonight.
Well, thank you, Lloyd, for that advertisement for the Oak Initiative. How many Oak Initiative members do we have? I thought this was a Christian gathering. Wow. You can join the Oak Initiative for any size donation. And but we need your money. I'm not going to lie to you. You know, but it is, I think, a fellowship of some of the most high-impact people I know who are really doing things. And we are small on purpose. I'll explain more about that later. But we're not just looking for anybody to be a part. We are looking for high-impact people who we call them the force multipliers. Which, if you've ever heard that, it's a military strategy. Remember, we're talking about being the army of God. Thank you. And, you know, there's some groups that are so effective, or some people that are so effective, it's like, you know, some special operators in the military can be worth a battalion of regular troops in the right setting. And after 9/11, when we decided to go into Afghanistan, you know, they dropped in some special operations, Delta Force guys and some Green Berets to just kind of spy out the land in Afghanistan while we could mobilize an army force in, I think it was Kazakhstan, where we were going to put together a major force to go in and invade that country and get rid of the Taliban, now Al-Qaeda. Well, while we're still mobilizing, these special operators and the Green Berets who were there took over the country. They finished the job, and they weren't supposed to. They were just there to spy out the land. And it's one of the amazing things, got very little press, but that's really what happened. Now, there's some places where you don't want to use special operations people. They won't do good fighting in the trenches or anything. They're trained in a special type of warfare. But my point is, I think there's some people that you may have never heard about. Some of them you have heard about. But there are people out there doing the most incredible things. And that's what we're looking for in the Oak Initiative. Now, the Oak Initiative was named that after as the oak of righteousness in Isaiah 61. And an oak tree is, I think, compared to righteousness there, because a mature oak tree will have a root system just as large underground as it has branches above the ground. It has depth, it has content. And you know, all Christians should be deep. I mean, we're given the Holy Spirit that we're told searches the depths, even the depths of God. And so I don't think any Christian should ever be shallow in their understanding. There should be this compulsion in us to go deeper in everything. So this is kind of a fellowship of that. And we have done some things like that little video when I got Boykin. And I did ask him to do it on Marxism. I said, how were you trained as a Delta Force operator to recognize Marxist insurgency? And he sat down, did it in seven, I think it was 7 minutes. You may have seen it. It went everywhere. Within a short period of time, we were getting 20 million views. With 20 million views on our website, we were getting more people watching that every day than we were watching all the news stations combined. Just watching that one video. And Boykin and I were getting worn out with people sending it to us. Boykin was getting it sent to him. And he's complaining about it. But people would really send it to him and say, you really need to see this. But anyway, we have gained a reputation where people think we are massive. We are huge. We're not. And we're not looking to be. You know, we're looking to be, you know, a fellowship of those who really want to do exploits in the name of the Lord. And I want to talk a little bit about that a little more tonight, continuing on with the theme of us being an army. By the way, just go to theoakinitiative.org website. You can join up, or you can just get free material from the Oak. Just sign up to get free bulletins and what we call Oak Leaves, which are little short videos or messages done by people that give real behind-the-scenes understand to a lot of the major issues going on. But this was born. It was 300 people came together that meeting Lloyd was talking about. We had leaders of denominations were there. We had, you know, in a cross-section. I mean, we had Greek Orthodox sitting next to wild Pentecostals and all kinds of things. And there was a bonding that took place because all of these people recognize that our country is under threat. It is under threat, and we could lose it very soon. Now, I know a lot of people think that's a foregone conclusion. I totally disagree with that. I absolutely disagree with it. I know some even say, well, America is the Babylon in Revelation. That is not so. I want to take that load off of you if you're carrying that. Because I could prove it by the scriptures. And I do in our school every year. But people get this concept and they think, we're doomed. We're the great Babylon and all that. And I have friends that believe that, but it's not so. God wants to save our country. He has a purpose for it. And there are countries that are going to be sheep nations, and there are countries that are going to be goat nations. But if ours falls into that goat category, it happened on our watch. And we were not the salt and the light we were called to be. Now, I call Jerry Boykin about once a week. We talk all the time because he spends a lot of time in Washington and spends about 3 days a week. All he does is meet with senators and congressmen, and he hates it. I mean, he hates politics like I do. But I call him all the time. He gives me the same answer. I say, Jerry, are you still a Christian? He goes, how would you be doing if you lived in a brothel? You know, I mean, that's what he thinks of Washington. And I don't think he should give it that high of a compliment myself. But it's just a nasty place. And that should not be the case with the capital of our nation. It really isn't. But I was up there just a few months ago, and we had a breakfast as maybe 20 senators and congressmen, and it was a great time. But afterwards, one of them called me aside, and he just said, you know, you would see a lot more courage in Washington if we saw any courage in the church. And all I could say was guilty. There's not much courage in the church. And I believe there's a vacuum of leadership that is worldwide. I think it's in every field. It's not just government. It's in education. It's in sports. It's in media. And it's in the church. I mean, we have a terrible vacuum of leadership, and that is, as we discussed last night, one of the judgments that come upon nations when they start calling good evil and evil good. And we're suffering that right now. There is a vacuum of leadership. But you know, in the end of the book of Revelation, the first group that gets thrown into the lake of fire are the cowards. The first group. And they get thrown in before the murderers, the adulterers, sorcerers, all these evil, evil things, cowards going first. And I tell you, I believe the body of Christ, the church right now, in America especially, is the weakest it may have ever been. Cowering before the LGBT community. And the things that are going on where 1% or 2% of the population are just tearing our liberties away from us one after another with almost no protest. Because we're afraid of being called a racist or being called a bigot. Well, yeah, have you noticed how some of those who are so freely casting about and using those accusations are the most guilty of those very things? Those who are demanding the most tolerance are the most intolerant people we have. Somebody's got to stand up to this. Now, it will get you in trouble. It will get you enemies. I tell you, the worst thing that could happen to us, though, is to stand before the judgment seat of Christ on that day and hear, "You were a watchman and you didn't warn my people. You were a shepherd and you did not protect my people. You let this happen." Or that we were supposed to be the salt and light in this country and we let it go into the corruption and decay without a protest, just hiding. Basically, and refusing to stand for the truth and righteousness. Yeah, you get accusations. Don't ever look me up on the internet. You know, don't look up my name. Yeah, I scare myself when I go there and look at the stuff that, you know, is put up. And I did make the list of the most... the worst enemies of Islam. I'm on that list. I was proud of that. I wanted to hang it on my wall. I finally made it. Now, I was a little ticked off because Jerry made it all the way up to the top five. I'm still down around number 30. But I'm going to work my way up. Now, I do believe radical Islam is one of the ultimate enemies we're going to face, and you can never defeat an enemy you do not recognize. We need to understand what this is. It's coming against us. And you can understand, more and more are. One of the things I do appreciate that I think Boykin has been instrumental in doing, and all those, now it's been almost 4 years of meeting every week with senators and congressmen and panels and everything. They have gotten an education on this. And many up there of the key people do understand the incredible threat that this is. Now, on the other side, from a spiritual side, the rise of radical Islam in the world today is the judgment of God on perversion and abortion. It's just like the Lord, when Israel fell into apostasy, he would raise up the nations around Israel to discipline Israel until they cried out, repentant of their sin, and cried out to God again. The Lord is allowing this to happen until we repent and start walking in what we're called to walk in. Now, we've got a lot of our missionaries, Morningstar missionaries. We have about 500 missionaries around the world. Now we have, they're in 60 countries, 60-some countries, I lose count. But these are high-impact people, too. We've got between 16 and 20,000 churches under our missionaries just in India right now. And some of these are some of the greatest missionaries, I think, that have ever lived. One of our guys has over 7,000 churches, and these are real, vital, living churches under him. And they don't know they're connected to Morningstar. I'm talking about all the churches. Don't know. We don't care about that. We're trying to build the kingdom. But these people are having an incredible impact. But the ones I really like are some of our guys who are right around ISIS in Syria and Iraq. And we sent one of our missionaries over there. We helped buy a kitchen for him. Just a, you know, kitchen, got it sent over. Within days, he is feeding 50,000 refugees two times a day. All of his workers. Now, he's planted churches. He's got churches in European countries that are bases, like in Greece and other places. But he's planted churches all over the place. Many of his workers and his best workers are former Al-Qaeda and Taliban. And these are, to me, some of the greatest. You want to talk about true apostles, the real thing. I mean, these are the real thing. They're doing extraordinary exploits. One of our top guys over there, I can't use his name or tell you much about him, but he goes behind ISIS lines almost every day that he's over there to help rescue families and things like that. A lot of our guys do. They're just doing incredible things fearlessly for the gospel. How can we not stand up against the mess that's going on in our own country? You know, and the sacrifices Christians are making all over the world today. Many of them laying down their lives every day for their faith. How can we not just take a little criticism and accusations coming at us? Because we stand for biblical truth, God's standard of righteousness, His standards of justice. And but, you know, when I was a new believer, the Lord started showing me about a certain company of people that were going to come in the last days, that He was going to raise up to do great exploits. And I don't want to get into too much of them, but about them, but they're going to be extraordinary. They're going to be God's Delta Force in these times. And they're alive. They're among us. Some of them, I think I know who they are. I know what they're about to do. Many of them are already doing absolutely phenomenal things. But Bob Jones, just before he passed away, he used to have the Shepherd's Rod experience where every year he'd go before the Lord to get a word. The Lord would show him things for the coming year. And some of the things he got were spectacular and awesome. And, you know, everybody heard about him. And but he did his greatest things, I think, in the last year of his life. Some of the greatest things. Maybe the most spectacular of all, the last night of his life. I don't want to go there. We'll be talking about it all night, okay? But he, in his last shepherd's rod, he went before the Lord, and I was with him in this experience. As an experience, he said it's the only time he's ever had anyone else with him. And the Lord was giving he and I gifts. And you know what he gave me? 12 Babe Ruth candy bars. I was so excited about that. I knew right away what that meant. Babe Ruth was a heavy hitter. He changed the game. And I think a lot of people, these special forces, these special operators, God's special operators, they're going to be like those Babe Ruth candy bars that are also full of a lot of nuts. You know, they're... These are the edgiest people you can imagine. Now, Jerry grew up in Delta. He was one of the first officers when Delta was first stood up. And, you know, Delta was a very prophetic force. Colonel Beckwith, who was the founder of Delta Force, you guys may know him. He's from Montana. He's passed away now, but he was from Montana. But he had a vision when he was in Vietnam of the special counterterrorism force that needed to be raised up, and that terrorism was going to be one of the greatest threats of all to our country. Now, get this. At the time he received that, the word terrorism didn't even exist. Nobody knew what he was talking about. And they kept saying, "You want to raise up a force for what? You know what? You know, I mean, this just wasn't on anybody's radar screen. He was so far ahead of the times." Of course, he did it. Remarkable thing, but Delta Force, let me tell you this about them. They are made up of the misfits of the Army. The guys who couldn't make it in the regular Army. Most of them. Now, and that's what they were looking for, to raise up this force, because they had to be those who could think outside the box. Now, I'd study Delta because I used to own an air charter service, and I got the contract to fly the Delta Force commanders when they were first being stood up as a force. So I won the contract to base two planes at their base to fly them, because they always flew in civilian aircraft because they always went undercover. And while I was negotiating these contracts, you know, to fly the Delta Force commanders, they would say, "Well, don't use that word. This isn't Delta Force. Delta Force doesn't exist." And it got so crazy, I said, "Well, does the money exist that you're supposed to pay me with?" But they were so secretive at that time. This is a true story. One of them, his wife thought that he worked for the telephone company, because she had heard him called a special operator. And he was keeping that much of a secret about what he did from his wife. And back then they wore long hair, still do. I mean, they do everything to look unmilitary. They don't observe any military protocol. They don't salute officers. They don't say sir to the officers. They'll call the commanding colonel by his first name, because they don't want to slip up in some bar somewhere and say, "Hey, colonel," or whatever. The Army really hated them for about 20 years. Really didn't like them at all. Didn't think they were Army. They were misfits. And I remember one time I asked Jerry Boykin, I said, "Of all the people you've met around Morningstar, who do you think would be a Delta Force operator?" He didn't hesitate. "Todd Bentley. That guy's Delta Force." Because they were nuts. I could tell you some crazy stories with these guys, but I won't go there. It's mixed company. But now they are a bunch of nuts, but they're unbelievably effective in what they do. When the History Channel did that special on all the special forces of the different armies and militaries in the world, all of them at the end said Delta Force in a league by themselves. Everybody, SEALs said that, everybody. Delta is in a league by itself. They turned down the assignment to get bin Laden. They said, "Oh, that'll be easy. That's piece cake. Let the SEALs have that one." I'm just saying, they're nuts, I told you. But I think we have some among us. We need to start appreciating the nuts who are around us a little more. And if you don't fit in, could be because it's designed by God. You know, now I've tried to always preach a respect for all the churches, all the denominations, and we should respect them. They're deserving of respect, but there are a lot of people who just can't fit into the church in any of its forms today, hardly. And they're weirded out about it too, but I tell you, it's okay. It is okay. And maybe you're being called to something else, something really different, but incredibly effective. Now, when I was a young believer, the Lord started speaking to me about this group. Actually, Enoch prophesied about them. And, you know, the book of Enoch is quoted in the book of Jude. And where he talks about the Lord coming with his holy tens, some translation, tens of thousands. It's literally, you look it up and check it out, his holy 10,000. It's not many. there aren't many, that he doesn't need many. He doesn't need many of these. Now, just like the Delta they may have done an extraordinary thing in Afghanistan, did what the Russian army had not been able to do in over 20 years. They did it in a matter of weeks. Some things, some situations, they can be incredible. Some, they cannot win a real war. It's going to take the regular army to do that, and all the other forces, Air Force and everything else. You understand that. But there are some among us that are weird on purpose. They were created that way. Now, Lord started putting things in my hands and giving me little revelations along the way about the leadership he was going to raise up in the last days. Now, some of the things I'm talking about here, I'm talking about this special force. Some of it, I'm talking about a new breed of leadership he's going to raise up in the last days. A whole new breed of leadership. But one of the things, how many of you have ever read any of the books by Alexander Solzhenitsyn? You know, a few, you know, extraordinary Russian writer. He was a disciple of Tolstoy, who I think was the greatest novelist of all time. Solzhenitsyn was close. But he wrote this book called August 1914. Have any of you read that? A few of you. Yeah, I think it's one of the most prophetic books I've read about a parallel of the church in our times. God's army. Now, August 1914 was the beginning of World War I. And in this book, it's about the condition of the Russian army as World War I begins. And I think it's a very close parallel to the condition of the body of Christ in our time. Now, there's a saying, there are many soldiers, but not many warriors. And there is a difference. There is a difference. And soldiers can be good, they can be great professionals, but a warrior is a different kind of person. The Russian army didn't even have many true professional soldiers. Most of those who had gained their positions, the high positions in the army of command, everything else, had gained those positions by political manipulation, self-promotion, marketing themselves, instead of being competent at their job. Listen, this is a parallel of the U.S. military right now, too, what's happened over the last few years. But very few of them really knew how to do their job. So there were a handful of true warriors, real professional soldiers in the Russian army. And this one Colonel Vortensev was one of them. And he only rose to the rank of colonel, even though he was more competent than maybe any other general in the army, simply because he wasn't self-promoting. When everybody else going to the Tsar's ball or whatever, to hobnob and, you know, win friends and win advancement, he would stay home and study. And he studied, you know, it says study to show yourself approved unto God. And one common denominator I think you will find with every high impact person is they don't waste their time. And because he studied so much, he knew the strengths and the weaknesses of the Russian army. Then he also started to become prophetic. And I think a whole lot of prophetic perspective comes from studying. You look at the incredible expanse of knowledge in the biblical prophets, the knowledge they had of other nations and all. And many people have a concept, well, God just downloaded that information into them. It's not how it happened. He would download revelation that gave interpretation and understanding to their knowledge. But these were students. You know, the big difference between the major prophets and the minor ones was the expanse of their knowledge. The expanse and the depth, I should say. But they were like Daniel and those, who just excelled in knowledge in all fields and everything. And that's kind of like this Colonel Vortensev. He became deep, and then he started becoming prophetic. And he started to perceive that a war was coming, and it was going to be between his country and Germany. So he starts studying the German armies and the German tactics and the German generals and their weapons and everything. And he started perceiving how this war was going to unfold when it would start. He said there were very few others like him in the military, but when they met each other, they would instantly know, you're one, you know, you understand. And they had a fellowship among them. Themselves. But anyway, cutting this short, you should read the book. It's really incredible. It's a historical novel. This stuff really happened. But he, you know, the characters and all were probably made. But anyway, the battle unfolded just like he foresaw. And as he understood what happened, the Russian generals lost their armies. They didn't even know where their armies were. Now, they didn't have internet and not even telephones and all like we did back then. They would run wires and they would have telegraphs and things like that. But an artillery shell could cut the telegraph line. But Vortensev understood this is going to happen to the Russian army. They're totally incompetent. They're going to lose their armies. They're going to lose touch. And we're going to get run over by Germany if we don't do something. So he was basically a messenger boy attached to the Grand Duke's staff, who was a commander-in-chief of the Russian armies. So he just went in one day and asked the Grand Duke, can I go to the headquarters of one of the armies to see how they're doing? He said, yeah, because they had lost communication with all their armies at the headquarters too. Nobody knew what was going on. So he races off to the headquarters of one of the armies. And he goes in, the commanding general sees him, but lets him in, and we'll see him because he comes from the Grand Duke's staff. And he didn't come in and say, you idiot, you lost your army, didn't you? He came in and he said, General, you understood, I know that the Germans are going to come through these passes right here, and you know they're going to come with these weapons. Isn't that correct? He said, yeah, that's exactly what they're going to do. And he said, and you, where did you send this division and whatever? Well, down this road, when? 3 days ago, okay, they marched so many kilometers an hour. So this, your division here is right here. You've got them in a great place. They're positioned well. And then anyway, he paints a picture for this general so the general understands where his army is. And he said, I know you know what the Germans are going to do next, so you're probably sending messengers right now to have this division move to this point, and this one here, and whatever. The general's going, I was just about to do that. How do you know? So anyway, he starts manipulating the whole battle for this general. He sees the messengers go out, so he races off to the headquarters of the next army, does the same thing. Pretty soon, this colonel's manipulating the whole battle, and nobody knows it. He didn't care. He just wanted to save his country. He didn't care if anybody ever knew what he had to do with it. He was a professional. I tell you, you've heard of the nameless, faceless ones who are coming. They really don't care if anybody knows who they are or what they're doing here. Matter of fact, they are repelled by it because they can't do their job if people start to understand who they are. Anyway, in this book, it tells the story how this colonel was able to position the Russian armies to encircle the Germans and cut them off and could have won the war in August of 1914, the very first month of the war. Now, what happened? One of the Russian generals panicked and surrendered his entire army to a thin line of Russian machine gunners. And the whole front started to unravel. And, of course, then the Bolsheviks moved in and the rest is history. My point is, though, I believe there are people today who are behind the scenes doing far more than you could imagine to position. They're not complaining about the incompetence of the leaders, or they understand, they know it, they'll talk about it, but they're positioning people, the right people, in the right places, and God's forces in the right ways to be ready. This time, we're going to win. And we have to get it into our hearts. We win. That's Scripture. In Isaiah 60, when darkness covers the earth and deep darkness the people, the glory of the Lord appears upon His people. And then the very next verse says, and the nations will come to the brightness of your rising. The light wins. The darkness does not win. We've got to get that out of the core of our understanding. Now, we could all die. We could all be martyred, all killed. I don't care how it happens. We may not be here. I don't care if I witness it here or as a part of that great company of witnesses. We're going to witness a victory. We're going to witness the victory of light over darkness in the ultimate battle of light over darkness. Now, this confuses a lot of eschatology for a lot of people. It needs to be. The lot of, you know, I've studied every eschatology I've been able to find, and there are a lot of them. There's more than pre, mid, and post-tribulation. There's all kinds of stuff out there. And I think all of them have some merit to them. All of them also have conflicts within themselves about their own eschatology. Conflicts within Scripture that you can see. And without getting into that, just read all of my books and you'll know the truth. But it does talk about, in Daniel 11, 31, 32, talks about the abomination of desolation. And by smooth words, he will turn to godlessness, those who act wickedly toward the covenant. But the people who know their God will display strength and take action. They're not running. Warriors run to the sound of battle, not away from it. We're not going to hide. We're going to be in the thick of it. Saving souls, reaping the harvest. We can't be passive. I know I had to restrain Jerry from saying this on live television. But he told me, he had just told me this. We were doing a TV show recently and we were talking before the show. And he said, if one more Christian comes up to me and says, oh, I'm so discouraged with this and that, but God is in control, he says, I'm going to punch their lights out. He said, I've never seen so many Christians use that as an excuse for not doing anything and for hiding. Well, right after that, this little girl, one of our workers, comes up. God is in control. Don't hit her, Jerry. Don't hit her. Don't hit her, Jerry. Now, we know the truth is God is in control. But he's not controlling, manipulating every little thing, as we often think. You know, the sovereignty of God and the free will of man are both true. Heavens are the heavens of the Lord, but the earth, he's given it into the hands of the sons of men. We really do have free will, and he is sovereign. He can intervene. He has the power anytime he wants. I think what Lloyd was sharing today about, you know, how apostles aren't just led around by the hand, they're sent. They've grown in maturity and wisdom. God corrects their course occasionally. But, you know, there are a lot of things that show incredible immaturity still on so much of the body of Christ. And one thing you can look at is how people take up offerings. I mean, think about it. Now, you guys didn't do that here. I was just so appreciative. Just matter of fact, just do this. But in most places, like, you've got to promise the people, you do this, you're going to get blessed. You're going to reap, harvest a hundredfold and all this. And all that's true and all that's biblical. But it's like time after time, we just got to badger them and compel them to do it for their sake. Why not do it because we get to be a part of what God is doing? We get to be a part. It's a free will offering. And it's important it's free will, because where your treasure is, there's your heart also. That's why we ask members of the Oak Initiative to give something. We know some people giving $5 a month could be equal to someone else giving $1,000 or $10,000 a month. So, and to God, that $5 may mean more. We understand that. But there's something about, if your heart's really here, you're going to put your treasure into it. And, you know, the Lord gave, it was a free will offering by which he built his own tabernacle. It's what the people freely gave. Same is true. When you hear people saying, you hear preachers saying, if you don't give to this, this isn't going to be done. That's right. God won't do certain things unless his people are behind it. And they show that by their wanting to support it. Okay, those are facts. But why don't we start taking up offerings with, okay, here's a purpose of God. Do you want to be a part of that? Do you, you know, it is something to sow into, not just so we get. We're feeding people selfishness. You know, one of the warnings about these times was woe to those who nurse babes in those days. And to me, I interpret that as woe to those who keep their people in immaturity. And there's certain things that just keep people self-focused. What I get, it's all about me. And said, no, it's bigger than that. It's not all about you. It's about God and his purpose. It's about us laying down our lives, becoming disciples. You know, the Great Commission is not to make converts, it's to make disciples. Have you read the definition of what a disciple is? What Jesus said his disciples were? You read his definition of disciple, you'll probably think, I don't know many Christians that are disciples. Guess what? Not many Christians are disciples. Not according to the Lord's own definition of it. But I tell you what, the disciples have searched that out. But let me tell you this about a disciple. Disciple lives every day. The main priority and focus of their life is to be like their master, to learn of their master, to become like him and do the works that he did. That's the driving focus of their life. You know, there are five levels of relationship to the Lord in Scripture. You guys know those five, don't you? No. Lloyd does. Lloyd, you got to tell these people this stuff. But no, there are five levels. You know, a believer, and that's great. Being born again is critical. You know, I mean, that's the start. But when you're born as a person, that's not the end of your life. That's not the goal. That's the beginning of things. And being born again is not the goal. It's just the start. An important one, can't be without it, but it is not the goal. It's the beginning. After that is discipleship. And that's what the Great Commission is, to make disciples. And not just of people, but of nations. And he just defines that, teaching them to observe everything he's commanded. And he also just defines it many other ways, taking up your cross daily, you know, all these things, loving not your life unto the death. After a disciple, it's servant. Now, I don't believe you can be a servant until you've been a true disciple and matured as a disciple. Then you can become a bondservant. And that is a different thing. And listen, you know why most people don't understand the book of Revelation? And why most of the books written on the book of Revelation are so distorted? They're written by people who are not even disciples, hardly, much less bondservants. And he says right up front, this is a revelation of Jesus Christ, which he gave to him to give to his bondservants. If you're not a bondservant, you will never understand that book. And a bondservant, I can tell you this about the nature of a bondservant. Bondservant didn't wake up today and say, ah, what a great day. Wonder what I want to do today. A bondservant woke up today, Lord, thank you so much for this wonderful day. what would you have me to do today? Because they don't live for themselves. They live for Him. They were bought with a price. They don't get a big check in the mail and think, wow, man, this is great. I'm going to go buy that boat I've been wanting. Or that. They don't even think that way. A bondservant, Lord, thank you for trusting me with this. What do you want me to do with your money? Everything they have is the Lord's, and it's not just a cliche. And they live for their master. You know, I was focused on this for years. Lord, help me be a better servant. And I wouldn't claim to have been close to being a good one. I was trying hard, but He kept giving me really tough jobs. It's mostly about restoring people. And then things, it gave, you know, that we got that heritage property, the PTL, USA, Heritage USA. You can't believe the condition that was in. It had been empty for 7 years. Homeless people have been living in it. I don't even want to tell you what it was like. He was giving me assignments like that. People to restore. Nobody else would touch. And, but listen, I have to admit, I was taking some of those people selfishly and helping. You know why? Years ago, the Lord gave me a dream. And in this dream, one of my children had fallen into a sewage ditch and couldn't get up. In this dream, I'm there, I can't help. I'm, you know, like, I'm just an observer. And a bunch of people gathered around my child and just started ridiculing, laughing, that they couldn't get up. And you can't imagine the grief of a parent, it was just despair. I could do nothing about this. And then in my dream, this man comes up and helps my child up, gets them cleaned up, and out of the ditch and on their way again. In that dream, I was right then, I will give everything I own to that person that helped my kid. Everything. I really would have. I mean, you know how you feel as a parent. They could have had everything I owned for helping my child like that. And the audible voice of the Lord came to me in that dream and said, Jim Baker is my kid. Will you help him up? And I knew that one thing, you know, this is the father watching what happened is, you can't believe the hate mail Jim got in prison. I read some, it was what Christians were writing to him and saying they hoped happened to him in prison is unbelievable. And he was off to about every day, he'd pray for the Lord to take his life. And he said one day is one of the worst of all. He was literally cleaning toilets, just been through unbelievable hell in that prison, praying for the Lord to take his life. And the guard came and said, you've got a visitor. Come with me. And he thought it had to be his lawyer because his lawyer was the only one who had visited him in prison or communicated with him. And he was probably the most despised person on the earth at that time, mostly by Christians who felt ashamed because of what he had done. And true, you know, he understood that too. He said just a few days before he had watched on television how Billy Graham had been awarded, you know, this or given this title of being the most respected person in America. And Jim, he loved Billy Graham, but he just couldn't help it. Man, you know, I have brought more shame on the body of Christ and on the name of the Lord. I've done the opposite of what this man has done. He just wanted to die every day. Well, this few days after this, he gets a visitor. The guard tells him, he says, can I go change? Because he had filth all over him. He said, no, you don't have time. So he takes him in there, and there's Billy Graham. And he said he just wrapped a big hug on him and spent 8 hours with Jim that day, just encouraging him. And to me, that is true Christian nobility. That is a true Christian spirit. But when, you know, the Lord said, Jim Baker's my kid, will you help him? I couldn't wait to help him. Because I know you want to get favor with our Father in heaven. Help one of his kids nobody else wants to help. When they're down, can't get up. And you guys, I know there are a lot of investors here from Raymond James, and hopefully you got all these customers here, didn't you? No, it doesn't look like it. But you know, basic investment strategy is buy low, sell high, right? You don't buy high and sell low. Try doing that with people. Invest in them when they're at their lowest place. You'll make friends for life. And the return on your investment will be far more than it could ever be. I was, you know, I talked a little bit last night about our meeting with Donald Trump last Wednesday. We're going there. Some of these guys are saying, I just want to be his friend. I said, forget it. You don't make friends when you're at the top. You make your friends when you're at the bottom. They say no successful person makes friends, because everybody wants to be your friend for the wrong reasons when you're successful. And I'm just saying, but that's the way it is. Now, that's not true, too. When you're at the top, gracious people, and God can work things out, and you can make friends. But as a rule, you know, I'm going with people. I said, that isn't going to be why we're going in here. He's got the friends he needs, or the close ones. Maybe God will do some other things, but God has to do that. Does that make sense to you? My point is, invest in people when they're down. Don't just try to invest in people when they're up. I'm just saying. And, but you know, a lot of privates in man's eyes are God's generals. He showed me that, how some obscure people that you'll never hear about in human history books are the real heroes of the great battles and wars. He says some of the great battles were won by a private, not the generals. It was a private who just said, I'm not going to run. I'm going to stand. I will not retreat. And they gave courage to a few more and gave courage to a few more, and the lines hold and the battles turned, and the general gets all the credit, but God knows it was a private. It was that private. Now, my point is, I hear people talking about what's the president going to do for his legacy, and I honestly think no Christian should have that mentality. We don't do anything for our own legacy. I think that's a wrong devotion. One thing, it's not about us. But God has his own history books. They're called the books of life. They're accurate. Man's history books are never going to be accurate. All of them have been politicized. They've been spun. They've been, almost every event has been that way. So why care what people write about you? Why care whether your press is good or bad? You know, we know that God has the accurate story. Let's just be sure. And that's what Jesus said. Don't even rejoice that the demons are subject to you. Rejoice that your names are written in heaven, and they're written right up there. And the record is right. It is accurate. It is absolutely accurate. And you know, I was flying from somewhere up in northeastern U.S. and over Pennsylvania one time, the Lord said he wanted me to stop, land, and go to the Gettysburg Battlefield Park. He said, I've got something to show you about the coming leadership. Now, I grew up on a Civil War battlefield in Richmond, where most of the battles took place right around. And I wasn't too interested in that kind of thing then. But I went down there, and walked around, went through all the tourist traps and everything you could do. Didn't know what the Lord was trying to show me until I happened upon this one statue. It says, General Governor K. Warren, the Savior of the Union. I said, what? The Savior of the Union? Now, by the way, you may have seen a History Channel did a special on this. They used my teaching. They really did. But I'm just saying. I'll get credit in heaven for that because they didn't pay me anything. But I don't care. But anyway, I couldn't believe it. So I went and I grabbed every book I could on the battle and everything. Find out what was this guy? Who? What did he did? But Abraham Lincoln's the one who called him that, said 5 minutes in the life of this general possibly had more to do with the outcome of the Civil War than all of the other decisions made by all of the other generals combined. Think about that. 5 minutes in his life. Now, he was a general of engineers. He was over the Corps of Engineers, which they were the ones who built the bridges and dug the trenches and everything for the troops. He was not even a commander of combat troops. He was over the engineers. Well, the first day of the battle, the Confederates had pushed the Union troops way back, and they were just bracing to be beaten again because they'd been beaten so much by the Southern troops. And he just said, I'm going to do something. Remember, those who know their God will display strength and take action. He just took action. He said, I'm going to do something. Got on his horse and went out scouting just to try to understand what's going on with this battle. I immediately saw the most strategic point on the battlefield, this one hill called Little Round Top. And if the Confederates took it, their cannons could sweep the field. They would drive the Union forces, cut them in two, actually, and would be able to march straight into Washington. It would probably have ended the war. And the Southern troops were coming up, climbing that little round top when he saw them. So he raced back and started ordering troops. He didn't have authority to do that. He started ordering all the Union troops he could find up to that little round top, to that hill. They got there with just enough men, just in time, to hold the hill and keep the Confederates from seizing it. Of course, the rest is history. If he had not done that, it almost certainly would have been the end of the Civil War and a Southern victory. So he could have saved the Union. He didn't do anything major before or after. But that 5 minutes meant a lot. He's prepared. Here's my point. I think some of God's greatest leaders, they may be being prepared for something they do in minutes. The right time at the right place that can change everything. But they're men of action. They're proactive. They're not passive. They're not passive, like he was not passive. Of course, if you read the story of that battle, Colonel Chamberlain, he was sent to the, it was his regiment that was sent, it was like the very end of the Union line that took the whole brunt of the Confederate attack. Time after time, they attacked his point till finally they ran out of ammunition. And all the Union generals were up top looking, watching. They're saying, oh no, they could see they're out of ammunition. They're going to retreat. The lines are going to fold. Instead, Colonel Chamberlain, who was a history professor, wasn't even a professional soldier. But when he became one, he started studying strategy, tactics, everything good. Because if the men actually elected him their commander, so he said, I'm going to be the best commander. For their sake, I'm going to be the best I can be. And at the point where everybody expected them to retreat, he told his men to fix bayonets, and he commanded them to charge. And it so shocked the Confederate troops, he drove them off the thing, and preserved. He too could be said he saved the Union. With what you don't know what's going to happen, when or where, when a microphone's going to be thrust in your face with cameras pointed at you. You could say something that turns everything. I'll tell you, one sentence under the anointing can change the whole fabric of our country. Now, I've seen 1,000 years of the enemy's strategy unraveled by one prophetic word in a parliament where everything changed and everything you could tell in the history of this country, not it wasn't this country, it's another country, where the devil for 1,000 years had been setting something up, and it got unraveled. One prophetic word in their parliament, it all turned back. Maybe you're that one. Nobody will know. Maybe you won't do anything great before or after. But wouldn't that be great to do something like that? To do exploits. Now, I think most of those, like I said, they're proactive people. They're people who are engaged in doing things all the time. The courageous are courageous all the time. It's their nature. Now, I want to tell you about one more soldier story, all right? This is just kind of painting a picture of the kind of leaders I think are coming. The Lord showed me we're coming. Have you ever heard of John J. Pershing? Wow, last group I asked, nobody had ever heard of this guy. But he was our commander of U.S. forces in World War I. And let me just tell you a little bit, because I believe his life is a parallel also. When the Spanish-American War broke out, he was 38 years old and still a first lieutenant. He was the oldest first lieutenant in the Army. He'd gotten one promotion in 18 years. One promotion. There were generals in the Army younger than he was. He's a first lieutenant. He didn't complain. He didn't whine. He did what Vortensev, he spent all of his time studying. He wasn't a political guy. He wasn't, and that's one reason why he kept getting passed over. But he had this attitude. He said, if I remain a first lieutenant my entire career, I'm going to be the best first lieutenant this Army's ever had. That was his attitude. Now, he won a Silver Star for gallantry in the charge up San Juan Hill with Teddy Roosevelt and the Rough Riders. And he got promoted to captain, 03, which is just one more. He had two promotions in his career. Remained a captain until he was 44 years old. Same thing. Oldest captain in the Army. It's same attitude. I may be a captain when I retire, but I'm going to be the best one this Army's ever had. Roosevelt, near the end of his administration, remembers Pershing. He said, I wonder what happened to that guy who was with us in, you know, Spanish-American War. So he sent somebody to find out, where's Pershing? Whatever happened with this guy? And they found he's still a captain. Teddy Roosevelt promoted him from captain all the way to brigadier general. 1 year later, he was made commander of all U.S. expeditionary forces and commanded our forces in World War I. Here's my point. I believe there are people that maybe you're, for 20 years, 25, 30 years, the highest, best thing you've done is run a home group, but you've run that home group or that prayer meeting or whatever like it was the most important thing in the world, because you did it as unto the Lord, not for men. I believe there are a lot of obscure people. Men have not noticed you, and you don't have that self-promoting, manipulating, marketing mentality for yourself. You're just not going to do that. It doesn't matter, but you haven't wasted your time. You have not wasted your time. You're going to see a huge promotion at the right time. God has not forgotten you. He's not overlooked you. Well, just a little over a year after he had been a junior officer, he's sitting in the council with prime ministers. And he was called in by the prime minister of Britain and the prime minister of France. He got there with the first U.S. troops when we entered the war. And they called him in. And they said, we are so glad you guys are finally in the war. We can really use you. We have taken such a beating in the trenches. We need your reinforcements in the trenches. You're going to help replenish us so we can hold off the Germans longer. And you know what he said? He listened to them, and then he stood up and he said, gentlemen, I have considered your strategies and I've rejected them. We're not going to do that. And he said, I didn't bring my boys here to die in the trenches. We're going to win this war. Sounds like typical American arrogance, doesn't it? But that's what he said. He said, I don't even want my troops to learn about trench warfare because we're not going to stay in the trenches. We didn't come for that. He said, I'll let you use a few of my officers for a little while because I want them to get a taste of combat. But we didn't come here to die in the trenches. We're going on the offensive. Okay, what happened historically, the Russian front, you know, collapsed. And all of a sudden, Germany can take all of its forces from the Russian front, the Eastern front, move them to the Western front. They were already pressing and just about defeating the French and British. And with all this huge reinforcements coming from the Eastern Front, everybody expected them, the Germans, to win the war that spring. The Americans were just barely getting there, didn't have much experience, were green troops, most of them. It looked like the end of the war. Sure enough, spring, major German advance. They just bust right through the lines. They just start pouring in like everybody expected. Pershing went on the offensive. And not only offensive, he attacked the strongest point of the German lines, the Ardennes Forest. And you can read all this in history. Some of you may know this. He went on the offensive. Devastating casualties. Horrendous casualties. 120,000 killed quickly. And, but, you know, he persevered. We know history. He created a breakthrough in the Ardennes Forest. And just weeks after it looked like a certain German victory, our troops broke through the German lines. And all of a sudden, the whole German front collapses because they have to. Once you break through and get into their rear areas, they've got to fall back to keep, you know, to protect their headquarters, to protect all their, you know, resources, everything else, keep from being surrounded. But the whole front collapsed. And just weeks after it looked like a certain victory for Germany, their Kaiser's fleeing in exile. And the war was over. Now, here's the point. I think, you know, one thing, Pershing did not disrespect the French and the British. He had a great respect for them and what they had done in holding those lines. But he knew this can't go on forever. This can't go on forever. We're not going to just replenish your things. Now, I think the new breed of leadership, when revival breaks out and harvest and all these new, fresh people are coming in, I think the prime ministers are going to be saying to this new breed of leader, oh, you're going to fill our pews again. You're going to fill our meetings. You're going to fill our services. But I tell you, this new leadership's going to have to say, we didn't come to die in the four walls of your churches. No disrespect, but that's not the church we understand it to be. And we're going to go out into the streets. We're going to go out where the war is, into everyday life. But anyway... so much more that we could say about all these, the Allied victories. Now, you know, to me, one of the great leaders with extraordinary wisdom was the French General Foch, who was the commander-in-chief of the Allied forces. When Pershing said, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to send my troops to the trenches, Foch grasped it right away, and he approved it. He said, I think you're right. I think we've got to do something drastic and out of the box. It's probably the only chance we've got. So, and he got everybody else behind him too, and it was a joint effort, no doubt. But there is a new breed of leadership, and there's a harvest coming. There's a massive ingathering of new believers coming in, but they're not coming in to die in the church as we have known it up until now. Okay? I'm just saying, now you may have heard this story too. I'll just finish the stories on them. But years later, when Pershing was dying, in Walter Reed Hospital in Washington, four young majors came to see him when he was on his deathbed. And the nurse that wrote the story said, Pershing rose up and laid hands on them. She said it like this, like Moses laid hands on Joshua. And bless these four young majors, their junior officers. Well, you know who those majors were? Clark, Bradley, Patton, and Eisenhower. So there is something to impartation. You know. So, but, I, you know, all I can do is kind of, you know, the Lord, when he preached the gospel of the kingdom, he never gave us a clear definition. It's like this, it's like this, it's like all, and you got to put the whole thing together. And I'm just kind of shagging a lot of different things here. I hope you see, things are about to change radically. And one thing that's going to change radically is the leadership. There's a new breed coming. There's a new breed coming. Now, I've got more to share on this. I'll download some more tomorrow, but it's in the books. Are there any books left? Have you guys bought all the books? There's a few. Mostly the what? The trilogy? Okay. But you can go online and buy the books. And the stories are a lot better in the books. I'm a much better writer than I am a speaker. But it's, I think there's a different impartation comes when you read something as opposed to when you hear something. We need both. We need the preached word, but we also need the written word. But I can tell those who love preaching, I mean, you guys wouldn't have given up your time to be in a meeting like this if you didn't love the word and love preaching. And you can, I can always tell those who love preaching, good preaching, because there's a vibrancy to their life. There's a freshness. There's something there. But I can also tell people who love to read. There's a depth to them. And we really need that. We need the written word. If he who was the word would take his stand on it is written, we really need both. And of course, we need the scriptures much more than we need books. But the books are part of it too. They help water the seeds and things like that. But we need to know the trail that God has us on personally and know what seeds he's sown in our life and be careful to cultivate them. That's what he talks about, cultivating faith. Psalm 37, other places. Cultivating doesn't mean you just hear the word and forget it. No, if you have really received the word of God, we know the good soil, they're going to take care of that seed. They're going to be sure it gets watered. They're going to keep the weeds out. They're going to cultivate it until and protect it from the birds of the air, everything else until there's fruit from that seed. That's part of our discipleship we learn in the beginning. How to husband the seeds that God plants in us to bear fruit, to bring forth fruit. Okay, last night I enjoyed the question and answer time. But you wore me out. I started going brain dead at the end. I was, and when I, you know, I can't believe I actually had jet lag. I recognize jet lag now. You know, I was a jet pilot for many years, and I used to tell people I never get jet lag. And then when I quit flying professionally, I found out I'd had it the whole time. And now I recognize it. And it's, the way it works on most people, not just me, but definitely me, is all of a sudden you're talking and all of a sudden it turns a switch off. You can't even remember what you were talking about. And I really did this. And I'm confessing my sin. But I had been on a trip. I think I was in New Zealand or Australia. Came home for a few days. You can't begin to recover. And it takes you about a day for every hour you're out of your normal time zone to recover from jet lag. If you're 7 hours difference, it'll take you about 7 days. So I was 12 hours off. Come back 3 days, go to, I think it was Switzerland. Come back. I am so mixed up. I mean, I don't remember my name. And I get back home, first day, and this couple in our church comes up to me. We've decided to get married. Will you perform our wedding? I said, sure, I'll perform your wedding. Tomorrow? I said, what? Are you kidding me? There's no way I can perform a wedding tomorrow. They said, no, we really want you to be the one performing. I said, you don't understand. My mind is way out over either the Atlantic or the Pacific. I don't know. My mind is not here yet. They said, well, we've written our own vows. We'll print them out. All you'll have to do is read them. I said, well, I guess I can do that. You remember back when laptops and all were first coming out and these printers, and how sometimes they would just print blank pages? Well, my mind's blank, but I can read, and I'm reading their vows, this big wedding. Next page is blank, and I'm blank. I had to make it up as we went. I don't know. They said I married them three times. And at one point, I'm going, in the name of the Father and the Son. And what was his son's name? But I can't believe this is only 2 hours off of my normal. But I was going blank a few times last night. It's like I recognize that jet lag. I didn't even come here in a jet. I came in a little prop plane. But have mercy on me. If you see me going blank, pray or do something or get ready for a mess. But we did have a couple of questions that were really good. I said I would answer tonight. And might have time for a couple more, see how far you guys want to go. But one of them was, what happened to the franchises? Remember when I talked about the encounter I had with the Lord when he said, you're not planting churches but franchises? Well, I don't know what happened to those churches. I spent from last night until now trying to, what happened to those? Yep, bless my heart. I lost them. I don't know. But actually, I do remember this. I went around to every church, and I repented to them. Because I had a serious encounter with the Lord. And, you know, he convicted me with some things. You know, where Paul said, when it pleased the Father to reveal his Son in me, then I preach. He didn't say when he revealed him to him, but in him. Then he preached. And I had, because I was such a student, I would study 40 hours a week minimum when I became a new Christian. Now, I always read and studied everything I could get my hands on even before I became a Christian. I just love knowledge. And but when I became a Christian, this like the mother lode. There is a God and you can know him. I mean, it can't get any better than that. So I just study like crazy. And within 2 years, I had more knowledge in some things than a lot of pretty experienced preachers did. So I got asked to pastor this church when I hardly even knew the Lord. And I didn't think that was God at all. I was on my way to Miami to join this missionary group going into South and Central America. I just wanted to be on the mission field. And I stopped in Raleigh, North Carolina. And for some reason, I'm just sitting in the back of this church, and the pastor asked me if I have anything to share. I mean, nobody there knows me. But I did have something. I wanted to fix his sermon. Yeah, you're wrong. Zero wisdom. I had a lot of knowledge. You can have a lot of knowledge and be stupid. But anyway, I don't know what I said, but it was enough that he came to me the next week and said, you're supposed to be a pastor of our church. I said, you're the pastor. He said, no, I want to be your assistant pastor. I mean, this is crazy. And these are mostly university students from NC State and Carolina and Duke University are all right there together. And I said, I don't think so. But I called the guy that held, you know, headed up the mission group in Florida, and I told him this crazy thing. These people want me to be their pastor. He didn't even have time, didn't have to pray, but he said, I really think it's the Lord. Because he was afraid of me coming down there. I'd have wrecked the whole thing. I really would have. But anyway, he convinced me, you're supposed to do this. So I did. And I was the worst pastor I've ever heard of in my life. People would come to me for counseling. I'd say, well, get over it. What are you coming to me with your problems for? I got my own problems. People needed inner healing after coming to see me. And you think I'm joking. That's the truth. But that was my whole counsel to anybody. Just get over it. And one good thing happened to that. My wife was a little college student, and she wasn't my wife yet. She came to me for counseling, and I said, I am the answer to all of your problems. So I got a wife out of the deal. But really, I had no experience, no wisdom, making up as I went. And you don't even want to know some of the bizarre things we did. But God would back us up sometimes and do incredible things. But he was constantly having to clean up the mess. It'd be like coming home one day and meeting your five-year-old at the door. Daddy, Daddy, I cleaned the house for you today. And you're going, oh, my God. You know, and you go look and, oh, son, we'll fix it. We'll fix it. But you're so proud of your son. They just had such a great heart. And I think that's the way most of our ministry is, by the way. Lord just saying, that was so great of you to try to do that. I so appreciate that. I'll fix it. I'll fix it. But it's certainly the way my ministry was, may still be in a long, lot of ways. But I did go around to a lot of, I'd already planted a bunch of churches. And I went around to them. I told them, look, I have really been so shallow. And I felt like Job, you know, at the end of the book when he says, I've only known you by the hearing of the ear. Now my eyes have seen you. I repent. I said, you guys need better and deserve better. And I released them all. I did. I said, you go find a real leader. And I'm going to go get to know the Lord. And that's when I took a flying job. And you start flying this little Learjet for Leon Hess. He owned Hess Petroleum. And used to own the New York Jets, too. Used to promise us all the time, we're going to the Super Bowl this year, boys. Set aside the time. I never set aside the time. Those Jets weren't going anywhere. But but anyway, I would fly. Usually every Monday we'd fly somewhere, maybe several hours of flying. Then we could sit in a city for 2 or 3 days, and I had all that time for study and all. And it was great. But, you know, I really did just walk away from the ministry, cut all those churches loose, and said, I've got to get to know the Lord before I try to, you know, lead God's people. I mean, this is the most serious people you could ever lead. These are the royalty. These are the king's kids, you know. So anyway, that was kind of that was a long-winded answer to your question, wasn't it? I hope they're still Christians. They could be in the Al-Qaeda by now. I don't know. They may. I kind of lost track with them, but I hope they're still Christians. Okay? How do we get to know his voice better? Didn't you ask that too? Okay. What do we do to get to know his voice? One thing, I think we've got to be intentional. I don't know where this passive thing comes upon so many Christians where if God wants to do it, he'll do it. No, it doesn't work that way. He says earnestly desire spiritual gifts, because if you don't care enough for them to earnestly desire them, if you don't value them that much, it isn't going to happen. You're not going to get used. You're not going to get these. So I think we've got to be intentional. We've got to be in pursuit. It says, seek and you will find. And that's literally keep on seeking. Don't quit. You know, keep on knocking. Keep on persevering. First, we've got to want it bad enough to know his voice. Now, I've read a lot of books on knowing the voice of the Lord. I've written books on the prophetic, but I've never written them on knowing the voice of the Lord, because I don't believe that's how you come to know the... I don't think there is a procedure. I don't think there is a formula for that. Think about it. I could totally describe technically my wife's voice to you. And she could come here and talk, you'd never know it was her. I don't care how much you knew the technical, she's a soprano, she's whatever, you just still, because you had the technical knowledge, you wouldn't know it. But because I've been around her so much, if she was in a group of 200 women but was talking, I would know right away, that's her voice. Because I've been with her so much. And I think that is really the only way you can get to know the voice of the Lord. You got to be with him. You've got to be with him. There is no formula. It's personal. How many people can you recognize by their hand? I mean, if someone had a digit missing or something unique like that, you probably could, and you knew that about them. But let's just say most people, maybe even your spouse right now, if you saw their hand with 10 other hands, you may not be able to pick out their hand. I think most Christians only know the Lord's hand. But that's why they can't distinguish his hand. They don't know when the devil's giving them something, and the devil does give God's people stuff as bait. They can't distinguish his hand from the Lord's hand. There's only two ways that we recognize other people, basically, and that's by their voice, if we've been with them, and their face. I think that's the only way we can get to know the voice of the Lord. And we got to know him, see his face. We got to know him by that. Now, there's a lot more could be said on that, but I think the greatest gift we could have is hunger for God, desire to know God, and to be in that constant pursuit. And I think it does take discipline, though, where we care enough to study what it means to be a disciple and resolve we are going to be the best disciple we can possibly be. And I had an experience a couple of summers ago where I was riding my motorcycle, the longest ride I've ever been on. And the Lord told me to do it. And I was hurting. My knees were in really bad shape. I thought I might be able to make 200 miles. And I had to go like 700 miles. I said, it's going to take me 3 days. When I got 200 miles, my knees were almost locking up, and I heard the Lord say, keep going. I said, okay, but I'm trusting you, but I don't think I can put my knees down at the next stoplight, you know. And after 200 more miles, they felt better than when I'd started that morning. Short story, my knees got totally healed. And I had the ride of my life. It was like the Lord sitting on the back of the motorcycle. I have never had that kind of personal relationship with him. Now, I've had encounters with the Lord. I've seen him a number of times. I've been caught up before his throne in spiritual experiences. I've seen him face to face in the flesh twice. But it was always slave to master, soldier to commander. Lord, tell me what to do, and I'll do it the best I can. I was trying to be a good servant. I was trying to be the best servant I could be, but that was my whole relationship to the Lord, and almost all of my revelation was coming as instructions and things to do and all, and that's, I was good with that. Now, I wouldn't have called myself a very good servant, but somehow, you know, the Lord always grades on a curve. It's called the cross. It's called grace. But anyway, somehow he told me right at the beginning, that right is like all of a sudden I felt the Lord's presence in an incredible way. And he started talking to me. My first response was, Lord, when I get down there, I'm going to finish this book for you. You know, it's still about what I do. First thing he says, you know, labor's cheap. He said, I can get anybody to write those books. I could even get Lloyd to write them if I want. But he said, but friends are expensive. And this is what he said. He said, I don't have many friends. And he says, today you're no longer a slave, but a friend. But he said, but I've got to deliver you of that slave mentality. He said, but you couldn't have gotten here without it. Paradox. There are a lot of paradoxes. He said, you couldn't have gotten here to this point where we can be friends now. Without that devotion, you know, I spent years trying to be the best disciple I could. I'd spent years trying to be the best servant. Then all of a sudden he said, now you're a friend. He did it to his apostles a lot faster. But they lived with him day and night for 3.5 years. I think they had a little advantage over us. But anyway, I didn't know how to relate to him as a friend. Now, I'm going to share something with you that could be profoundly life-changing. It impacted me and has been still radically changing some things in my heart. I don't know if it's manifesting yet, but things in my heart more than just about anything in many years. Okay. But he started talking about how friends are expensive. You've got to invest in a friendship. You know, you've got to give time. You've got to take them out to eat. You've got to care enough to be intentional with those that are going to be your friends. And he said, it's anymore. He says, not about what you do. It's about what you become. And then I kept resorting back to, I'll do this for you, whatever, because that's the only way I'd known how to relate to him. It was habit, you know. I didn't know how to relate to him as a friend. Finally, I just broke down and said, okay, Lord, when are you going to let the Panthers win the Super Bowl? I said, let's talk about men stuff, you know. And and you know what he said? I said, Lord, and his voice, he was loud and clear. It was like talking to one of you. I've never had that kind of experience before. It was that clear. It was just conversational. That's what he wanted to hear from me. I said, Lord, do you really care about our preoccupation with sports? Or I don't know, I'm not preoccupied. I never even watch a whole game unless it's the Super Bowl. But I watch parts of them. I keep up with scores and occasionally go to games. You know, I love it. And but I just said, Lord, do you care about that? He says, do you even like football? What do you think of football? He said, I love football. Because my people love it. He said, I love the things that you love. He said, I only wish that you would take me with you to the games. I only wish that we could watch the games together. He wants to be a friend. I mean, but he had given us a word about the Panthers coming and about it being a mark of revival, a certain revival breaking out in Charlotte and things like that. So I was interested for that reason too. But I asked him all kinds of questions like that. But anyway, here's another thought. This led to this question. Remember when the Lord said, depart from me, I never knew you? They had done all kinds of great stuff for him. And their problem wasn't that they didn't know him. That wasn't the problem. The problem was he didn't know them. How could that be? He knows our thoughts. I'm just asking you to consider, maybe he doesn't. He could. He could know every thought. And I think most in the world, he probably does. But with his bride, that's not how he operates. You know how he doesn't remember our sin? He could remember every detail forever, but he's chosen to forget confessed sin. He doesn't even know it existed, doesn't even know what happened. He has chosen that. I just ask you to consider, maybe he's chosen not to know the deep things of our own heart unless we, his bride, are willing to share them with him. Look at the Psalms. David was a man after God's own heart, wasn't he? You look at how he poured out everything to the Lord. Even his complaints, his discouragement, his depression, he was real. God was his friend, and he could be real with his friend. So one of the local pastors and myself, we kind of had this revelation together. So we just started doing it. Just trying to share the deep things we feel and all and everything with the Lord and do everything with. It's been revolutionary for us. I just ask you to consider that maybe this is the case. But something like that has to be the answer. Because he said, I never knew you. And you know that word know doesn't mean he didn't know who they were. It was a deep, intimate relationship he did not have with them. And there's something about us being real and sharing what we really feel with God that I think he is longing for. But then there's another level. Okay, I'll dump this on you. Probably do this. It's kind of getting late, so we may not do the Q&A thing tonight, all right? But this is important, I think. After friendship, there's sonship. And a lot of these things are ambiguous in Scripture because it's like when Kierkegaard was pressed to give a definition of Christianity, he wouldn't do it. He said, I'll belittle Christianity if I give you a definition of it. He said, and you'll try to determine if you're a Christian or not by how well you conform to my definition instead of developing a relationship with Christ. So some things you can overdefine. And there are just a few little hints about sonship and what it means to be a son of God. Now, in a general sense, we've come to him, we're born of God, we're all sons and daughters. We know that. But there is something about a real position with God where you're a part of his family. You're not just invited to the wedding feast, you're the bride. There are distinctions there. Paul, I mean, you can see him clear once you see him. It's like those little puzzles that you can't see anything at all, but once you see it, you can't not see it. And I think the Lord has hidden it until somebody's ready to run the race for that, because this is serious business. I think it's the most serious business there could ever be. But when Paul in Philippians 3 said, I don't think I've yet attained, but I press on, he wasn't talking about salvation. He wasn't talking about eternal life. He had that the day he believed in the atonement of Christ. He said, he didn't think he had attained, but he pressed on towards the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Think about it. Here's Paul the apostle near the end of his life saying, I don't think I've yet attained, but I'm pressing on. I'm going for it. He even said, this one thing I do, this is the focus of my life to go after this. And I think this is what he was talking about. And he saw it was so high. Just think about that. Maybe the greatest apostle yet to live on the earth. Didn't think he had made it yet. But there's something to this. But now I try to spend 2 weeks a month just with the Lord. Next year I'm hoping 3 weeks, weaning myself off running the organization. That's my main job. That go before the Lord, get stuff, get it out. It's my main job. But last year I was, my dad died a complete invalid. I mean, he could blink his eyes. That's all he could do. Couldn't move his head, move anything, couldn't talk. And he lived with us. We kept him in our home for several years before he died in that condition. It was the hardest thing for me to deal with, probably ever, just seeing him like that. But then I had this terrible thing. I've been praying ever since, Lord, please just take me quick. You know, I don't want to go through that. Just for anything, I wouldn't want to go through that. Now, I would ask him, Dad, are you having visions? Or you communicating with the Lord? And he'd blink his eyes, so I knew he was. But anyway, this is just the most terrible thing you could imagine. So I was having this encounter with the Lord last summer, and we've been talking a lot about friendship, and I'm trying to be a good friend. I'm still struggling with learning to do that. But I said, Lord, what is it? How do you get to be a son? What does that mean? He was telling me all this stuff about being a son and what it means, the authority that comes with it and all kinds of, but then he ruined it all by saying, you know, the Father scourges every son he receives. And Lord, can you count this as a scourging? Can you count that happened back there? I mean, didn't I get martyr points for all this stuff? You know, for flying these airplanes forever and, you know, going to all these. And they showed me what scourging was. Now, as I said last night, this is a doctrine. Getting old sucks. Any of you like it? Now, the older you get, the more you become like a child. And pretty soon people are having to take care of you again. And if it goes on, pretty soon it's almost total take care of you. And that's not anything. Look, doesn't it say perfect praise comes from babes? Just think about this. Now, this is not a doctrine, but I believe it is the truth. That the older we get, the more perfect our praise can become. And if we enter into that point where we're totally helpless, that can be where the greatest praise and worship could come. And one of the greatest opportunities we could have in this life. Now, to me, it's the biggest cross, the greatest sacrifice. I mean, that would be the most terrible thing. But I also believe it could be the greatest opportunity. Now, I think maybe if we've done all this while we're getting up, maybe we don't have to go through that. I don't know. But, you know, I had an experience almost a couple of years ago, where I got caught up into heaven for 8 hours. And I've been in the heavenly realm a number of times, and everyone was different. I mean, heaven is big. It's more diverse than the earth by far, or than the whole physical universe by far. Because the whole physical universe is just a shadow of the heavenly realm. But I was in another part of heaven. This is the best part of heaven I've ever, ever been in. And, there's no way to describe it in human words. But the Lord asked me, he said, do you know how you got here? I didn't think I did anything. You know, I've always wanted to have these experiences. I do ask for them. I figured he'd just answer my prayer and go. He said, no, you use the key. I said, what did I do? Now, a few days before, I'd been the sickest I'd ever been in my life. I ever remember being. I think I had the bird flu plus Ebola. I never even imagined anybody could be this sick and survive. It was just the worst. I couldn't get out of bed. I was blind. I was so sick. And I've tried to do every day. There's certain things that scripture says brings pleasure to the Lord. A number of things. And every day I try to do these things because what can we do more important in our life to bring some pleasure to God? You know, do something, bring him pleasure, bring him joy. Things that it says bring him joy. So I just resolved. So I'm trying this day when I can't think straight. I'm doing my best, and I really did a bad job. I thought the worst job ever, and I just said, Lord, that's the best I can do today. Heal me, or I can't do any better than that. But I got healed, you know. And then I was at the beach where that happened. I go to Moravian Falls, our retreat center, and I'm there speaking at this thing when I have this experience of getting caught up in heaven for 8 hours. when he said, "Do you know how you got here? You used the key." I said, "What key was that?" He said, "You used the key to eternal joy." I said, "What did I do? How did I do that?" He said, "When you set your heart to bring God joy, as bad as you felt," he said, "it's the joy of the Lord is your strength, not your joy." He said, "When even in that condition you did your best, that meant more to the Father than all the other times when you're feeling good." I'm just saying, don't waste your trials. Don't waste the dry times. And if we go on to being an invalid or something, maybe we could have our most powerful prayers. Maybe my dad was directing international events with his prayer. We don't know what he was accomplishing. Won't know until we get there. But all I'm saying, anything that happens to you like that, don't waste your opportunity. Don't waste your trial, especially to bring him joy. If we set our whole hearts, this is the main thing we're trying to do. Do the things that please him. Faith pleases him. We want to grow in faith. We're told how to cultivate faith. We've got to care enough to cultivate, to be intentional about it. But we're doing it for his sake, not just because of what we get. To bring him joy. Somewhere in all this is the pathway to the greatest relationship you could ever have with God. And I believe someone in this room could be God's best friend in the last days. You know, it's open to anybody who wants it bad enough. People ask me, "Well, you think you're going to be one of those 144,000? I said, "Heck no, that's too low. I'm going to be one of those two witnesses." So there's room for one more of you. But how bad do you want it? How bad do you want him? This is about the gathering of eagles. Really? Are we going to really be them? We can. I believe anyone here can. But the essence and the foundation of true prophetic ministry is simply friendship with God. When he said he wouldn't do anything without revealing it first to his servants, the prophets, there's nowhere in the law or anywhere else that he obligated himself to do that. But he won't do anything without revealing it to his prophets first because they're his friends and he doesn't want to do anything without his friends. Well, let's start by determining we're going to be the friend of God so much we don't want to do anything without our friend. We're not going to do anything without him. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Thank
you. Praise the Lord. Thanks, Rick.